501c3 nonprofit that I started after stepping away from the classroom after teaching for 10 years in a total of seven different schools. As she said, I have a strong passion for students with disabilities and educating our youth. I also have a strong passion for preparing, educating, and empowering women leaders, which is why I'm very grateful that Deborah asked me to be a part of this event. Brigham Young, an American leader in the Latter-day Saint movement, once said, if you educate a man, you educate a man. But if you educate a woman, you educate a generation. This evening, we have an awesome panel of local historians and storytellers that are going to share their journeys with us about what they, how they feel about women in education. And at the end, you'll be able to ask them questions. So if you would document questions as we move along on your index cards, that would be great. Our first storyteller is Ms. Stacy Lightfoot. As a low-income African-American female, statistics suggested that Stacy would continue to live in poverty, work on a low-wage job, and not obtain a college degree. Her mother was a single parent who made less than $12,000 a year, but however, she made sure that throughout her life she was surrounded by trusted adults and positive role models. Stacy is a proud graduate of Chattanooga School for the Arts and Sciences. She received her bachelor's degree in communication and theater from DePaul University in Indiana in 1999 and spent her last semester of college in Rome, Italy at Temple University Rome campus. She received her master's degree in international service from the University of Roehampton in London, England, which is equivalent to an international nonprofit degree here. As a part of her graduate program, she taught mathematics and English in Kingston, Jamaica. Stacy is now the Vice President of College and Career Success Initiatives at Public Education Foundation. She has helped thousands of students to see college as a possibility, as well as train many high school, college, and career advisors, such as myself, how to be effective. When I reflect on what I know about Stacy's journey, the words of Malala Yousafzai come to mind. One child, one teacher, one pen, and one book can change the world. Please let's extend a warm welcome to Ms. Stacy White.
Educational journey right there in a nutshell. How's everyone doing this evening? Great. I'm excited to be here, and I usually tell this story in front of a group of students, but I'll start out with this story. I grew up poor, and you know, many times when low-income students are poor, they don't know they're poor because they're surrounded by a lot of other poor students. But my mother always used to make us collect aluminum cans, Coke cans, Sprite cans, Miller Yellow cans, and keep them in this bag in our garage. Well, one day we did not have enough money to eat, and mom said, y'all go downstairs and stomp on those cans, because for some reason she thought the cans weighed more when they were stomped on. that doesn't really happen. But regardless, I'll never forget this. We stomped on those cans. We had our friends come over to help us. I think we were having a slumber party that day. And we turned those cans in and got about $7 worth of change to be able to get, you know, some food from the Burger King. And I reflect back on those times where our water was cut off, our lights were cut off. I always wore hand-me-downs. People used to talk about me and how I dressed in school. But there was something very different about me. It didn't matter, because that was just part of my story. When I was in high school, KEDS, K-E-D, the K-E-D-S, the shoes were really popular. They were like $19.99, and that was way too much for my mother to spend. So I remember going to the Family Dollar, getting some buddies, and I wrote my name on the back of them in a blue pen, and I said, well, I don't have KEDS, but I surely do have Stacy's. So I share that story because that is just a part of who I am, not necessarily allowing my circumstance to define who I am, not allowing my circumstance to define who I am. So when I talk to a group of students, I share my story. Students look at me and say, oh my gosh, you're so pretty, oh my gosh, you're so funny. But I love sharing my story, because at the end of the day, I want them to see themselves in me. I want them to know that I grew up in a single parent home. I want them to know that I was poor, and I'm not just saying I'm poor because I couldn't afford kids. I'm saying I'm poor because I had to stomp on some cans to get some food. I had to go over to my aunt's house to take a shower when my mother couldn't afford to pay the water. But my mother worked so hard, two jobs to make ends meet. Back then, we were too poor to be rich, too rich to be poor. So she couldn't get a lot of assistance with my sister, for me and my sister. But something about my mother, she was a quiet warrior. And she wanted something so much better for my sister and me. So she got us into arts and sciences. So I'm a proud product of a Hamilton County school, graduated from arts and sciences in 1995. But something about my mother, when opportunities presented themselves, she presented those opportunities to us. So to be able to go to a public school where the culture of that school was college, was a life-changing for me. And again, I'm in it, so I don't know how special it is, right? I don't know how special it is to go to a school that allows me to share my voice and to be quirky and to meet students from different backgrounds and different cultures. But I'm walking the halls of arts and sciences, and if you've ever been in the school, they have pennants of colleges along the hallways. DePaul University, College of Worcester, ETSU, Agnes Scott, Pomona, all of these colleges, and as a sixth grader, seventh grader, as I grew up in arts and sciences, I would just walk down the halls and ask myself, I wonder where I'm gonna go. That just became a part of my mentality. I wonder, the question for me was never, am I gonna go to college? It was, I wonder which of these places I am going to go. So growing up in a low-income family and being in an environment like arts and sciences, who had a life changer in that school for me? It was the school college counselor. Her name was Susan Shipley back then. Her name is Susan Street now, so I don't know if you all may know Susan Street. But Susan Shipley, it was Miss Shipley, was an expert in her field. She was on national organizations, she was in local organizations, regional organizations, as a college admissions professional. So Susan, as the professional that she was, understood a little bit about my background and my story and how poor we were. And she knew that I was just very different, and I just wanted to go to this small liberal arts college in the middle of nowhere, away from Tennessee. And she said, Stacy, I have the perfect school for you. I'm like, what? What? And I love Miss Chipley because I thought she knew so much. She had been to 400 colleges, all these admissions reps from around the world knew who she was. And she says, I've got a perfect college for you, DePaul University in Greencastle, Indiana. And because I was a student that said, I wonder which of these schools I'm gonna go to, I trusted Miss Chipley to know enough about me to match me to a college I had never heard of. But she knew something that I didn't, that school was the best fit for me. I needed something small, I was used to a small environment at arts and sciences. I needed something kind of liberal arts that allowed me to learn a little about a lot of different things. So I went to DePaul University, got a full scholarship to go, attend college for 4 years. Here I am, this poor black girl going to school in the middle of some cornfields. Now this is when the internet was just coming on the scene. So I still wrote letters when I was in college, and I'll never forget, I just drew corn on all of the envelopes. I said, oh, I know, I was into colored pencils. I'm like, this is a piece of corn and this hoe's gonna be good. Gonna look real good on this envelope. So I went to DePaul and had a phenomenal experience. Every day wasn't perfect. I was egged. I was called nigger walking down the street. I looked at artwork from students in the schools because their families were part of the KKK. But that's okay, because I did not let the outside define my experience and who I was. So although that experience at a predominantly white institution wasn't perfect every day, the experience that I took from it was unbelievable. I met the friends that I have for the rest of my life, and I got a chance to study in Rome, Italy. This poor black girl from the east side of Chattanooga walking the streets of Rome, because it was the culture of the college
that students studied abroad. 80% of the students at DePaul in Indiana study abroad. And I'm like, well, hell, if they studying abroad, I'm gonna study abroad too. And I made that work. Walking the streets of Rome, walking past the Vatican every day to my campus in Rome at Temple University, having this amazing experience. I remember being in high school reading this book, Dr. Ben Carson's book called Think Big, and about how a lot of times students, kids, especially low-income, underserved students, students of color, are not taught to think outside of the box. They are not taught to think outside of their comfort zone. It's scary. I mean, it's scary going to a college in the middle of some cornfields where you're being egged. It's scary leaving your family. But again, I did not let that define who I was. So here I am in Rome, Italy, soaking up the experience, realizing how easy it is to have an experience like this. I remember getting to our apartment complex in Rome and just walking up to the building saying, this is just easy. You know, you think of these experiences as something that's so far out of reach for you, but when you're there, you realize, hey, I can do this. And that sparked me to think even bigger. So here I am in arts and science, thinking about college outside of Chattanooga, going to college in Indiana, thinking about going to Rome. I'm thinking bigger and bigger, because once that bot grows, you're gonna want it to continue to grow. And once I came back from Italy and graduated from DePaul University, I realized how easy it is to live big, to dream big, and I have never stopped. After returning home, graduated from DePaul, I worked at Girls Incorporated. I love theater. I wanted to be an actress when I was at DePaul. My major was theater and communications. So when I came home, I realized that I needed a job. And Susan Chipley was on the board of Girls Inc. Susan Chipley said, girl, I think you would be perfect for Girls Inc. And she was right. I became the career development director at Girls Inc., fell in love with the world of nonprofit, decided to go to college and get a degree in international service. And where am I looking? I'm looking all over the world, because I'm a big thinker now. I don't have big money, but I'm a big thinker now. So I found a program called International Partnership for Service Learning. And I applied, and I went, I left my car, I left my mother, I left my family, and said, I'm going to London, y'all. And I did, and had a phenomenal experience there. As I was writing my dissertation in the computer lab in London, and I get an email from, lo and behold, Susan Chipley, who says, I'm starting a nonprofit called the College Access Center, and I would love for you to come work with me. And I said, oh, yes, ma'am, wherever you are, I'm gonna be there as well. So in 2003, I graduated in 2002 from the University of Roehampton, came back and worked with Susan, who started the College Access Center in January of 2003. I have spent my career, she did not sign up to be my mentor. She was just a fabulous person. But I have modeled everything that I have done because I want to be a Susan Chipley to thousands of students, hundreds of students. I want them to think big and see the opportunities outside of Chattanooga. If Chattanooga is the best fit for students, keep them here. But there is a world that is so much bigger than we are, and I'm so glad that I've had a part in seeing what that world looks like, thanks to Susan. So she was my influencer. She is the reason I do what I do, to impact the lives of hundreds and hundreds, thousands of students in Chattanooga, especially public school students in Chattanooga. I know we're here at Girls Preparatory School, but the amazing talent that is in our public schools, it is there. And someone needs to be there to hone it, to help them to be the Susan Chipleys for those students. So I work with college and career advisors like LaRonda. I travel the country. I'm on boards. I'm in associations, all to soak up information to help me become the best professional I can be in the world of college access. So that is my passion, that is my calling. And I'll end with this. One of the highlights of my professional career happened last year. I got a call from United States Senator Lamar Alexander's office who said, "Stacy, someone gave us your name and we want you to come testify before the United States Health Committee, Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions Committee, on what we need to do to help more students, especially low-income students, to go to college." So in May of 2015, I testified before the United States Congress and helped Senator Lamar Alexander shape and reauthorize the Education Act. So thank you all so much for your time, for your patience. I love sharing my story, but most of all, this is not about me. It's about the lives of students. I can call countless names who make me better at what I do. They say, "Oh my gosh, you're so great, Ms. Lightfoot." I said, "No, you are who great. I look at you and you are the reason I do what I do." Thank you all so much. She is the Director of Workforce Development and Training at Chattanooga State Community College. Let's extend a very warm welcome from Ms. Lulu Coleman.
Good evening. I'm so glad to be here with you on International Women's Day and during Women's History Month. That's pretty awesome. After working at Chattanooga State for 20 years, my thoughts on education have matured somewhat. I think I have too. From my role at Workforce Development, assisting many companies, and from my own professional development, and from the standpoint of the mom, and hopefully a STEM mentor for young women, thanks to Sheila's recruitment, I have formed some opinions about education and career pathways. A couple of things. It is a journey, so enjoy the trip. Find your path, find your passion, but develop your passion. You have to analyze and update your roadmap. So here's my story. I'm a first generation immigrant with family members attending a lot of top tier schools internationally. So college was really a question of where and what. However, what we have in our family is a lot of male doctors, and actually a lot of women with advanced degree that often left their career after becoming a mom. I'm Chinese. So Tiger Mom is a career path for many Chinese women. My own mother actually took a break for 20 years. She's an accountant. She actually went back to work while I was in high school. So it was a break. So back to me. Since I was good in math and not bad with art, I thought architecture made perfect sense. So applied. So I actually attended Hickson High School. So when we immigrated, we ended up here in Chattanooga. So after Hickson High School, decided to go to architecture, so I looked at Georgia Tech and looked at UT, and infinite wisdom, I went to UT following a boyfriend that's not my husband now. So see, it's a journey. system, changed my address after first year in college when my family moved to New York. Well, they actually dropped me off and went keep on going on 81. So that summer when I went home to take a job, I thought I would just transfer my mail. Well, since I was not a citizen, UT decided I had to pay out state. My second year when they found out my address is New York City. So then I had to transfer back to City College of New York. But I had some great classes because the faculty at City College also taught at Cooper Union. So some of the classes I took in architecture was a joint classes with Cooper Union. So that was pretty cool. But as I was finishing my last year in architecture, I discovered job opportunities for architect students was actually not abundant. And the sales role related to architecture could actually be pretty brutal. So one of my least favorite part of the architecture program is actually those design presentations. So how it works is after slaving for weeks, or sometimes month on your project, and this is before CAD, okay, I'm old. So you do inking on vellum, and then you go into a room and you have to take your drawings up. And you have to defend your design. And they throw questions at you. And so if it's a big project, there'll be multiple faculty. And then sometimes students are mean. Your fellow students are mean to you too. So that's when I discovered that maybe I don't want to stay with it. So I switched to engineering. My dad was thinking, well, you could have gone to med school. So I found engineering to be, I really like the black and whiteness of engineering more so than the design of architecture. And, you know, it's just personal preference. But on a side note here, I thought what I don't like about architecture is doing the sales pitch. But then now I realize my current job, I'm selling education and training to. So who knows? So after deciding on engineering, I was trying to decide on electrical and mechanical, but again, I'm a people follower. I follow fellow students and professors and stuck with mechanical engineering. And a professor helped me get an internship at TVA, and that became a permanent job after college. And then after TVA, well, actually 3 years into TVA, I decided I would grow as an engineer more if I find something smaller than TVA. So I went with a staffing company and ended up at Olin Mills. I don't know if people here know, Olin Mills actually designed their own processing equipment. So I ended up at Olin Mills for 13 years. So during that time, like I said, this is a journey, right? During the time, I decided I need to probably get a master's degree. So I tried electrical engineering, tried mechanical engineering, and then some MBA classes when I was got promoted into management. And then at that point, I was implementing CAD for Olin Mills. So I set up the network. So I thought, well, maybe I'll try computer science. So engineering. I didn't finish. MBA in computer science. So still traveling, the journey, the career journey. And along the way, that's when I became a mom. So I took some time off from graduate school, not work. But I did, when my son was in second grade, decided I need to look at a different path. So maybe I could get summer off. So I thought, oh, well, I'll teach. So I was teaching part-time for both UTC and Chattanooga State, but that didn't last very long either, because I applied for a different job and ended up on 12 months doing training and workforce development. So it was, I picked Chattanooga State because it introduced me to something I didn't know about. I was not familiar with the community college concept and found that to be very inspiring. One of my first projects was DuPont. And at one time, we had 99 employees at DuPont going through classes. And most of the employees in that training program, some I have done some college work, but mostly never thought about going to college. And so the company invested in them because they need for them to be more skilled. So it was a certificate program, but a lot of them actually finished associate degree. And actually a few weeks ago, I don't know if y'all are not, DuPont officially shut down Chattanooga operation. And I heard from five people from that long ago, and they were applying for other jobs and say, Lulu, can you write me a recommendation letter? I need my transcript again. And so those are the type of things that touch you. You know, you can help those people. You can, you know, we talk about mentoring. I never thought about what you're doing is actually life-changing, but it is. So then also, while I was at Oma Mills, you know, just because I was a manager of that department, I talked a lot of people into continuing their education program. So switching to at the college, convincing students and employees from different companies that education and career is really a continuum. You know, every job, even part-time jobs, is developing your future. And nothing, and there are different points that you make different decisions. So I really do believe that, you know, the K to J pathway from kindergarten to jobs, everything should lead to different type of jobs, and it doesn't have to be a straight line. Life make you evaluate things differently, and sometimes it's not purposeful, it presents a new decision point, and you have to pick A or B. And, you know, people say, find your passion. But maybe you can be passionate about something you are good at. And so it's really finding out what you're good at and maybe cultivate something so that you master something. If you master something, you have the confidence. And if you have the confidence, that could become your passion. So I don't really know which one's the chicken, which one's the egg. So with my own story and my involvement with other people's stories, their education and their career path, it is a journey. And the journey, like I said, it's not a straight line. But I think probably every story here, you know, you probably go through some curves and circles and everything. And for a woman, a mom, a woman professional, you know, the ability to maneuver will make our journey better.